Good evening. My name is Greg Mancios. I'm the director of the Murphy Institute, and it is my distinct honor and pleasure to welcome President Dilma Rousseff and all of you. Bienvenida and Mitch Mona. So for those of you who don't speak Portuguese and those of you who do, that was my poor attempt at Portuguese. So forgive me, but I will work on that. I would like to recognize the chair of our Labor Advisory Board, Arthur Chiotis, president of CW 1180. And there are so many distinguished guests in the audience here today. Forgive me for not pointing you out. And we have presidents and vice presidents of unions. We have leaders of community organizations. Thank you all for being here and for showing your solidarity. I want to thank Paula Finn, Sean Sweeney, and Veronica Ordaz for organizing this event and for making this possible. And most importantly, I want to thank our co-sponsors tonight, the Committee to Defend Democracy in Brazil. Madam President, I want you to know that defend democracy, or in the defend democracy, you have a smart, efficient, dynamic, and deeply committed band of women who are supporting you and the working class movement in Brazil. And it's been a pleasure to work with them. Thank you. The Murphy Institute for Labor Education and Labor Studies is part of the City University of New York. And as an institute, we're dedicated to first providing opportunities. How about this? Any better? No? I can't get much closer. Okay, I'm going to eat it if I get any closer. First, can we pump it up a little bit? I'll try shouting. First, to provide a broad range of educational opportunities to workers. Secondly, to provide courses of study that will prepare the next generation of labor and community leaders. Three, to conduct research on work and working class communities. And fourth and finally, to serve the needs of the local and international communities. President Rousseff has spent her life as a champion of poor and working class people, dedicated to amplifying their voice, expanding democracy, and creating a social and economic system of far greater equality. As you will see, our mutual concerns, given our mutual concerns, that it's no surprise that we all find ourselves in the same room here tonight. But President Rousseff is extraordinary amongst us. You'll hear a lot about her truly remarkable life in a few minutes. What I do want to say, however, is that she and her colleagues have set a very high standard for worker and social justice movements around the world. The Brazilian Workers' Party and the left-leaning Brazilian Labor Federation, the CUNY, was founded in the 1980s. CUNY is the same as the coup. I discovered today that half of us in this room have probably been pronouncing it wrong for years. The Workers' Party assumed national leadership in 2003 with the election of Lula da Silva and the subsequent election of Dilma Rousseff. In the 13 years that the Workers' Party was in national leadership, the advancement of the Brazilian poor and working class have been stunning. 45 million people were lifted out of extreme poverty. Think about that, 45 million. The middle class expanded from a mere 38% of the population in 2002 to a full 54% by 2014. And not only did the quality of life improve for poor and working class people, but also longevity. The dramatic improvements in the healthcare system under the Worker Party leadership led to an increase in life expectancy by nearly 5 years. I tell you, I wouldn't mind adding 5 years to my life, and neither, I'm sure, would any of you. If it is the defense and expansion of these enormous achievements and the protection of fundamental human and democratic rights that provide the urgency behind President Rousseff's global tour and her talk with us tonight. In August 2016, President Rousseff was impeached in what the New York Times, a newspaper not particularly friendly to workers' movements, described the impeachment as a soft coup d'etat. But when one democracy is attacked, something that we in the United States learn more and more about every day, all democracies are attacked. As we say in the US labor movement, and you may say this in Brazil as well, an injury to one is an injury to all. Dilma Rousseff served as president of Brazil from 2011 to 2016. For millions of her compatriots, Dilma Rousseff remains the rightful president of Brazil. We are deeply honored to have her with us. To introduce President Rousseff and provide a much more knowledgeable framework for the for her presentation, we have two esteemed colleagues. First, up to the podium is Miriam Marquez. Miriam has been a political activist in Brazil for over 40 years. By training, she is a public health nurse who specializes in healthcare for women and the LGBTQ community. She joined the struggle against the Brazilian dictatorship as a student movement leader in the 1980s. She has served as an officer of the Workers' Party movement in Brazil and is currently active member in Defend Democracy in Brazil. Please join me in welcoming Miriam to the podium.
So, welcome everybody, bem-vindo todos. Eu peço aos tradutores, eu vou falar em português, que é a nossa língua, a língua aqui do Defend Democracy em Brasil. Em primeiro lugar, eu gostaria de dizer bem-vindos a todos. É uma honra para nós do Defend Democracy em Brasil receber aqui esse momento da nossa presidenta com ativistas, com líderes tão importantes da cidade e do estado de Nova York. O Defend Democracy em Brasil gostaria de agradecer ao professor Greg Montes, the director of the board of Murphy Institute. Professor Sean Sweeney, a very warm thank you, Sean. Without you, without our connections and your connections to the workers' movement, it won't be possible this amazing partnership that we did in the last month with Murphy Institute. We would like also, a gente gostaria também de agradecer a Verônica Ordaz, a diretora de programas internacionais aqui, que nos deu muito apoio. E um agradecimento carinhoso a todos os ativistas, as ativistas, os militantes dos vários grupos organizados em Nova York, do Defend Democracy em Brasil, que trabalhamos duro em cada detalhe deste evento, da organização, com os companheiros do Murphy Institute. Na verdade, a minha introdução é muito rápida, eu só queria dizer...
I would like to say... I'm sorry, the interpreter is unable to hear because she's not speaking on the mic. We'd like that everybody have to in mind that this small group, this small movement here in New York actually represents that this homage that we would like to give this right now, the thousands and thousands of Brazilian citizens, women and men that are in the stride of the streets for over a year, that are organizing, mobilizing, that created thousands of networks, groups, collectives, lists on WhatsApp, telephone number lists, families, groups of intergenerational groups of all ages, colors, and movements in Brazil in order to defend our democracy. Brazil is in a very dangerous, risky situation. All the social policies are threatened. Every day, the rights of workers, of the excluded, the minorities, the women, blacks, natives, it's being attacked every day. Humongous retrocess, and we here from DDB would like to pay tribute and thank on our behalf all the Brazilian men and women that are in the streets and welcoming our president. We are very proud of this tour of success that you are doing here in the United States.
Welcome
and thank you so much for your struggle and your solidarity with democracy in Brazil.
Thank you. Thank you all, and thank you, Miriam. Next up to the podium is Dr. James Green, who will introduce President Rousseff and serve as tonight's moderator. Professor Green is a professor in Latin American history at Brown University, director of Brown's Brazilian Initiative, and the executive director of Brazilian Studies Association. Professor Green is the author, among other books, Beyond Carnival, Male Homosexuality in the 20th Century in Brazil, and also We Cannot Remain Silent, Opposition to the Brazilian Military Dictatorship in the United States. Please join me in welcoming James Green to the podium. Thank you.
President Dilma Rousseff, sisters and brothers of the labor movement, as a former member of CWA and SEIU, I'm very honored to be here at the Murphy Institute and giving my solidarity to the movement in Brazil for democracy. Brazil, the United States has a long tradition of solidarity with Brazil that goes back to soon after the military came to power in 1964. It led the first international campaigns against torture in 1970. Activists met and protested outside of the White House in 1971 when the third dictator, Medici, visited Nixon. The campaigns against torture in Brazil, when President Rousseff was a young activist imprisoned in São Paulo, led the New York Times and the Washington Post to clearly denounce torture and to denounce U.S. involvement in supporting the coup in Brazil. And in the process of democracy in the late 70s, academics in this country, Brazilian exiles, other Brazilians who were living here were very important in the fight to push the country for an amnesty law, disappointing amnesty law, but allowing people to return to the country and to push the country towards democracy. When trade union leader Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva was arrested and he was pushed out of his union after the strike of 1980. Trade unionists of the AFL-CIO were fundamental in carrying out an international campaign against his being charged for violation of the National Security Act, and activists around the country and internationally were in the cutting edge of the fight for solidarity with Brazil. When President Lula Inácio da Silva was elected in 2002, activists, members of NGOs, the vice president of AFL-CIO, Brazilian immigrants came together to organize the Brazil Strategy Network, to fight against any possible intervention of the U.S. government in the progressive government of Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva. And then this last year, when the right wing in Brazil decided to illegally depose the president, activists throughout the country and throughout the world, but especially in New York, and I must say, New York was at the vanguard in the United States of the fight for democracy, and everyone here should give a round of applause to the Committee to Defend Democracy in Brazil. When I started working on Brazil in the 1970s, there were a few Brazilians who lived in New York, and they concentrated on 46th Street. And now we know that there are tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, of Brazilians in the New York, New Jersey area. It's a vibrant community. A minority of that community, unfortunately, is active and engaged, but it is a very important and vocal minority, and they deserve the wonderful recognition for all the amazing work they've done over the last year. I don't think I need to tell this audience how special Dilma Rousseff is for what Brazil has tried to do since the return to democracy in the early 80s. The fight to establish the Workers' Party, the fight to establish free trade unions, the fight to carry out social justice programs which could eliminate the gap between the rich and the poor, the fight for a state that could provide minimal conditions for living for people in the country, have all been part of a struggle for democracy and beyond. And I think when the coup took place last year, many of us didn't fully understand that this was part of a much larger international process of the right wing consolidating its power all over the world. We've suffered our own coup to a certain extent, and the tragic events that have happened this last year with the election of Donald Trump, and the resistance that Americans are carrying out against Trump, something I never even saw during the anti-war movement, is something to be an inspiration for Brazilians who, in my assessment, are a little demoralized by the tragic situation in the country. And so I'm hoping that President Rousseff tonight are going to give us some words of hope and optimism to keep us feeling strong, to fight against what the neoliberal plan is doing in Brazil and in the United States and around the world. No further need to introduce Dilma Rousseff, but just give her a round of applause.
Boa noite ou boa tarde. Final de tarde a todas e a todos aqui presentes. Eu queria agradecer inicialmente ao Instituto Murphy, e aí eu agradeço ao professor Chancellor.
Professor of Mike, I'm sorry. I'd like to thank all the members of the Murphy Institute who gave us this reception and are giving us their support in this partnership between workers, union members in Brazil and United States. As the professor Sean says, if CUT was from the state of Rio Grande do Sul, it should be called CUTICHE, which is a joke with the southern accent in Brazil. So I'd like to thank from the bottom of my heart the professor and all the members of Murphy Institute who were with us here today, and also all everybody present here, but in special Defend Democracy in Brazil. This movement that is comprised of activists, fighters, who today showed me part of the resistance that to the coup that occurred, that I had no idea of the scope or size of this resistance, and I confess to you that touched me. That moved me, your determination moved me, going out to the fight, being present in each decisive moment, having a clear position regarding what was going on in Brazil. And I'd like to tell you
A importância disso
the importance of this to Brazil is that
que era anunciado aqui, que
what
era,
was being
que era
reported here, what was being done here,
Brasil,
would appear in Brazil and it would rupture the blockage of the media in
então,
Brazil as to the manifestations that were occurring inside the country. So
e
I thank
luta,
you because this struggle, which is our struggle or fight for democracy, it had here reverberation, more than
poderia
an echo.
Um echo
it could
Brasil,
be an echo, echo of Brazil, but it was not here. There was a spring
de ideias, de palavras de ordem,
of ideas, of words
Brasil.
Of order, of comprehension
essa,
of what was happening in Brazil. And this is your participation. I would like to tell you that this is essential. Why? Because we have a long fight ahead of us today in Brazil. All of us, we all know that a coup was happened, a parliamentary coup, but it was a coup, a dangerous coup, a coup that has clear aims. These goals go from its most violent misogyny in the words, rude words, in the insults. In other words, in the disqualification of a woman for being woman that cuts across the school, but it has some very clear objectives. And for these objectives or goals of the coup, against it is our, it's where our struggle is. I am not going to give you a speech here to professors. I am not going to give you a speech for people who have a notion of the coup. I will give you a speech for for companheiros that have to do with our inquietudes, for our comrades and the challenge that we have together. Thank you. It's exactly the fact that Defend Democracy is an activist movement that makes me start by saying what is the struggle that we have to take on in Brazil, what we have to do in Brazil in order to challenge this coup. We will have several fronts open, as if it was a one only struggle unfolded in many. First, we have this basic struggle that you here are in the forefront of it, and the struggle, fight for democracy. Another coup, the struggle to clarify that, in fact, you have two kinds of coup. You have a military coup, or you can have a parliamentary coup. A parliamentary coup, it's always when it's done against the Constitution. That is a parliamentary coup. You don't eliminate all rights, but you start affecting a few of the rights. And then the biggest right that a country can have is to elect its own president when it's a presidentialist system. I had 54.5 million votes, so it's a vote against 54.5 million votes. As a matter of fact, somebody told me something very interesting here today. She's not here right now, even, because she is a person that has multiple roles here in I already said she must have a genie. I imagine she has a genie because she's in several places. I told her in the beginning we were 18, and then one day the media asked me, how many are you? And she said, we are 54,500,018. It's our comrade, Andrea. Our comrade Andrea.
So, essa luta,
this struggle against the coup and for democracy, it's a strategic fight because democracy in Brazil,
nós sabemos,
We know.
É o momento em que nós temos
in which we have the possibility of transformation. Whenever there was democracy, we were able to achieve a transformation. It was for democracy, through democracy, that we were able to elect the first president. But it's not just a workman who is a president. It's a workman president that comes from the poorest region in Brazil, which is the Brazilian Northeast. He left the Northeast, his mother and him with their family, and a can of milk, Gloria milk. That was the, everything that family owned. It was one can of milk. So this person that combines a industrial workman from São Paulo with the poorest rural worker from the northeast of the country that was forced to move away due to the drought and due to our effort, our work. I think it was yesterday. Water came to Campina Grande. Obviously, water does not get to Campina Grande because the coup authors did the transposition of the San Francisco River. Nobody here is naive to think that in 6 months you can build elevatory stations 60 meters big. It's almost if it's like if you built a station like that. I'm sorry, because people will say that there was an elevatory station that was 60 meters big. It's actually, it's three stations. These three elevatory stations, they raise this water 60 meters, 20, 20, and 20, in order to raise the water all the way from down from San Francisco, 60 meters, put it up here, and make it go down using gravity. It was necessary effort from a government and a political decision to undertake that, because who said that was going to do that, bring the water from the San Francisco and bring it to where the drought is. The first one who said it was the king, Pedro II of Brazil.
From Dom Pedro II until President Lula, you must convey with me that at least a century has gone by. So it is not a trivial thing to have made this deviation of the waters from the San Francisco River. What is democracy? Democracy that brought a worker to become a president. And how did a woman got to be a president in Brazil? Through democracy. Both arrived through the fact that for the first time in Brazil, women could be president. In any case, we won, definitely, for the ensemble of the women in Brazil that women can be president. They, children can even play to be president, something they could not fathom before. Democracy is deeper, even. It has to do with a way of manifestation, of demonstrating a complex country of 200 million. The diversity, the plurality of opinions is important, but above all, what is important is to have a focus. The population has to be a focus. It's black origins. It's history of exclusion and lack of privileges against them, and that need to recover that history to guarantee that there are equal opportunities. If we have a country where everybody is equal in their own color, in their own appearance, this is Brazil. However, this country in which there is a way in the difference between each of us, equal opportunities so that everybody can have access to the richness. So there is a struggle that leads all the little struggles that we have. It is to perceive the value of democracy. To defend democracy is the most important task we have from now on. It's the struggle that begins with the coup that took place last year. Only to stop the investigations of corruption that were taking place, to pretend that the most corrupt would be caught as corrupt. At the same time, this coup was made for other reasons, we know, to put Brazil economically and political and geopolitically into neoliberalism. We had been escaped neoliberalism. Neoliberalism had started to be implanted in Brazil with the government of President Fernando Collor. He was able to dismantle some of our main industries. He was able to privatize some of our state-owned companies. And this was continued by President Fernando Henrique Cardoso. In 2002, that stopped with the election of President Lula, and from then on, from 2002 until my impeachment in 2016, we were able to prevent neoliberalism, and we relaunched an investment in Brazil. Because we were not investing in electrical energy before, and we did. They were not investing in finding oil, because, of course, it costs money. There is no way. You have to.
One
of the biggest reserves of oil, which is the pre-salt layer.
Colocar os pobres no orçamento.
And we also managed to put the poor in the national budget. And now the coup is to take the poor out of the budget. This is the fundamental characteristic of what this government is trying to impose. Our struggle against the retrocess is what's mobilizing Brazil now. If the constitutional amendment that created a limitation of the expenditures that will prevent the progress in education and health that Brazil needs. It was a constitutional amendment approved with an incredible lightness of mind. And people in Brazil did not have a deep awareness of what was taking place. And by now, they do know. Now, they know what's happening in Brazil. Of the 27 states of Brazilian Federation, there are mobilizations, popular mobilizations against the reform of Providence of Social Security. One deputy of the politicians, he says, how can you vote against the changes in Providence if the father, the priest and the clubs in my country are, in my city are against it. He talked about it as somebody who was noticing the level of opposition that people are showing against this proposal. And the central central of the workers, CUT, are having mobilizations due to the precarization of work. They are approved a law to pass to third parties all the activities. A hospital, therefore, can exist without having a doctor that is of its own. Everybody can be hired from somewhere else. workers would be contracted by intermediary enterprises. An enterprise of radio, television, magazines can not don't need a journalist. Every worker has become an individual enterprise. They will never be paid their benefits, vacations, pensions. They took away the obligation of companies, and they are taking away all the workers' conquests that in Brazil started in 1946. This is a process that is for social rights, very intense.
Eles estão atrasando o pagamento
dos mais médicos. Delaying the payment of the doctors, of the More Doctors campaign we have launched. They are reducing 250 doctors. These are doctors that we gave them some subsidy, and they have been serving 300,000 Brazilians, and they want to end up this program, because most of those doctors actually come from Cuba, and this new government has an allergy for Cubans.
Não é interessante porque eles falavam. Eles falavam bastante. É muito interessante.
They talked. This
eles
is very interesting.
Mal,
they bad-mouthed us for having invested in the port of Mariel to help Cuba's development. And when the accord was made between Obama and the Cuban government, then Brazil silenced about it, because they pretend to be what they are not, liberals. They are not like the liberals in the United States. The Brazilian elite has never wanted to educate its people, never wanted to raise the life conditions of our people. It is not the same elite of other countries.
Essa é uma luta fundamental.
This is a fundamental struggle. The second struggle
isso.
has something to do with that. It has to do with our economic growth. We cannot want, as a country, a country in which the economy grows and people impoverishes. We know that story. But the story that is happening in all the countries in the world where the financialization has increased, which is richness for the financial sector, but it doesn't generate work. And the money is concentrated, the growth of the national income is concentrated in their pockets. We cannot support this type of growth. We have demonstrated that we can distribute rent and increase the market. Brazil is not a commodities-dependent country. Brazil, besides, I'm very proud of this, that besides having an agriculture that is quite sophisticated, technologically sophisticated, because the level of adaptation that Brazil has conquered in desertic regions of Brazil is incredible, with the adaptation of seeds by the Brazilian company of agriculture that has developed new seeds. And we are adapting our cultures on the basis of not simply planting. Besides that, Brazil has oil. Brazil has minerals. But also, we have an airway industry. We have 7,000 meters deep probes for oil in the ocean. We do have an industry of pharmaceutical industry in Brazil and petrochemical. We have a pattern of industrialization that they may want to destroy. They wanted to destroy that many times before. And I think that that is, there is a process in Brazil right now of disindustrialization. And this must be stopped, and it will not be stopped by those who are in power now. So that is the importance of having in our agenda the distribution of income and reinforcing the internal market of Brazil, which is one of its biggest richness. Nobody can despise a market that has the potential of the Brazilian market. The more you introduce people and improve their life, the stronger this market becomes. We also have to be mindful of the national sovereignty. Brazil is now engaged in selling land. We cannot alienate our territory.
Eles dizem que eu coloquei
they say
barreiras excessivas
I have put excessive barriers in the selling of land. No,
primeiro,
what we not, did not accept was, first of all, to denationalize Brazilian land, to sell to other nation states. It makes no sense. Other state nations control the Brazilian territory. No country in the world does that. Second, we do not accept a certain type of attempt to control millions and millions of miles of square miles
to
companies, because this alienates the Brazilian sovereignty. And then, regarding the territory, regarding the production of oil, it is very simple to understand what happened in Brazil. We spent almost 100 years
obter nível de produção de
petróleo.
Vamos
obtain a decent level of petrol production. In the beginning of last century, we said Brazil has no oil. Don't try to look for it because there is none. Well, we tried. We tried. We're stubborn. And we went and we found it. Was there a risk in production? Yes, there was, as in any oil production. In areas that were even more difficult, we found oil in the bottom of the sea. But it was quite superficial oil, and it wasn't a very good quality. So even then, we built a company like Petrobras, and we built up a structure to support that industry. And in 2006, the research done by Petrobras brought us to the discovery of another type of oil region. Where is this oil? In the Brazilian basin. It's a part of the bottom of the sea, which is, by international definitions, a propriety of Brazil. And we went there and we found oil. Where was it? Why does it call pre-salt? Because it was underneath. You have the ocean, and then you have sand, and then you have rocks, and then you have salt. And under this salt, in the bottom of it works as a cork. There is oil there of good quality. And we know where it is.
Nós fizemos dois modelos.
So we made two models. We came up with two models. For traditional ways, places where we can have models of concession. When you know where it is, you know the quality of it, and you know how to exploit it. The lion's part belongs to the national state. The state has 70 or 75% of the proceeds from this oil. The rest belongs to the enterprise that is going to exploit, or the several enterprises that exploit it. And this is a partnership model, and it is used in places where oil is found in great
amounts, like in Norway, in parts of the Northern Sea, and also in some and almost other countries who have a lot of oil. The great oil producers of the world. And that is the model we adopted. Capital, high capital, international capital participates, yes, but not with the part of the lion. It participates with a smaller part. The question is that they want to diminish the part of the lion and transfer it to the private sector, which is a scandal, because the discovery was done by Petrobras. Petrobras created the technology.
When
did you see a country that was producer of commodities who has the technology for exporting oil in the depths of the sea with high temperatures and high pressure? No, the same thing is valid also for the mineral richnesses of Brazil. So the question of sovereignty goes through that, and it goes through the relationship between the public banks and the private banks. Brazil has been able to keep, after the flood of neoliberalism in Argentina, in Uruguay, in Chile, three public banks. Those three big public banks allowed us to distribute rent to the social programs. One is the Bank of Development, BNDES. Since Brazil has a sector that is extremely financialized, and is the National Bank of National and Social Development. It's the only one in the world. And perfectly, there is also the economic federal bank, which has already a network all over the country. It is through the Caixa Econômica that we distributed the subsidies to the families that we have developed for the poor families.
And from
what is the adequate technology? We made a list of a map of the poverty, which is very fundamental for... You know that poverty in Brazil is feminine, it's black women, you know where they are, you know where it is in a rural zone. This map helped us to imprint the mark of the poverty in Brazil and distribute that out throughout all the social programs. And this question of the sovereignty of Brazil, we have a struggle that is very strong. It is not possible to dismantle
this
attempt to dismantle Brazil. We do not think that the international capital cannot participate. Quite the contrary. We have always said, yes, you can participate, but within the conditions that are interesting to Brazil, not anyone. That is why in all places, in all sectors, we made partnerships. The first block, there was only one block that was for the oil. It was already, there was a contract before that, and that oil was sold to other companies. But the first time we discovered our own, the block called Libra, who participated? Petrobras. Shell,
Total
Oil,
CMOC,
Shell, you know who it is.
Total também,
Total, I think you also know.
É uma grande empresa de petróleo,
is a
privada francesa.
A French oil
CNOOC,
company, CMOC. Each one participates with 5%. two of the most important Chinese enterprises. What are they? They're private. One of them controls.
Controla o quê que ela controla? Toda a estrutura de logística.
All the logistics of the oil in the world.
A principal estrutura logística de petróleo.
The main logistics for oil exploration, the main structure for refineries or refining, I think, in that respect, they compete with the United States, but it's a great structure for refining. So that's what won the first bidding process. How did that happen? This way, 70% they have to pay in oil to Brazil, 30% they share amongst themselves in the rates, whatever their participation is. So what does that mean? It means that what they want, what do they want? They want to change. They don't want the 30% only. They want the 90%. What did we do? They want the other share. They want our share, which belongs to the Brazilian Union. What do they want? When I say they, I mean the government. The companies, obviously, if you go to any company in the world and you know there's oil, you know how, when. What is the amount of oil? Of course, any company will take that offer. They're not stupid. The problem is not the companies, it's the government that wants, that has to dictate the rules, not the company. A government, what is their rule? This is the rule of government, because this is the rule that developed countries, when they find oil, that's what they impose. That was the rule that's in effect at the north, in the North Sea. So what happens? What happens is that we have a sovereignty problem. We have to fight against that. What they are doing with our sovereignty now.
Além disso, tem todo o problema dos direitos.
There is all this problem.
Esse é um problema extremamente delicado, importante.
This is an extremely important, delicate problem, because it has to do with what is modernity, if not the enlargement and comprehension that people have more rights than they used to. They have more important rights than the ones that were acknowledged in the early 20th century. It's not just the socioeconomic rights, it's the women's rights, the LGBT rights, environmental rights.
Toda questão de direito,
all that issue around rights in Brazil is in question. The question of rights is in question.
Desafiada.
It's being challenged, more than challenged. It's being progressively being retroceding. Why do I say that? First, because I know this, whenever you create a ministry, some ministries where their role is to invest, organize. For example, the Education and Health Ministry, he has a level of responsibility that has to do with management, has to do with undertaking. The Ministry of Rights is different. It has to monitor the other ministries.
Even
because, for instance, the issue of women has to do with education, has to do with health. The issue of women has to do with culture.
So
it cuts across the other ministries. It has
a
major strength from the point of view of its presence and the fact that it empowers the social movements. Empowers how? It doesn't live in an island. Ministry of Women, Racial Equality Ministry, the ministry that takes care of LGBT rights, human rights ministries. They're not isolated. They depend on social movements. So what was, I think, a great conquest of ours we promoted conferences. How is a conference organized? A conference is organized at the level, municipal level, and then there will be a meeting, a state level. That conference was by the movements. What would the government do? It would provide support so that the conference could exist. As this is the best definition of what a conference is. In a conference, if I'm not mistaken, in the cultural area, and somebody asked a representative of a river rights or river inhabitants, the denizens of the river area in the Amazon, they asked this person. They were in a discussion, they asked him, what is a conference for? And his answer for me is great. He said, a conference is to check if everything is the way it should be. It's of an absolute precision. A conference is to make sure everything is the way it should be going. It's that folk wisdom, right? That the people has. That's what a conference is. It's make sure everything is going the way it should. It's one of the functions. The other is to have decision power, influence power, power in popular participation in when speaking with the state. So that is our responsibility at that point. We say this. The bad thing about this government is that it's a government of a rich, white, and old man. I have nothing against old people, even though because I am also old, I'm getting there. But this is three things. This is a small part of the truth of the problem of this government is to dismantle this conference structure. There were thousands of conferences with thousands of people that were making the life of the government hell, but it's in a good way. The Brazilians here know what I mean by that word, atazanar, or making life impossible, or harass. Why is that important? Because several things came out of these conferences, several things. For instance, movement for the homeless movement came out not as a whole, because the movement doesn't do things as a whole. The government has to work and find out how to accomplish that. But arose the clear importance of a program as Minha Casa Minha Vida, or My House, My Life. It came out of them. So I would like to tell you this. I started with the end, the democracy, and I conclude at the end again, democracy. Defend democracy here is a movement that has, in my opinion, has to reverberate in Brazil. This is the movement that makes a difference. We will have to fight for democracy. We will have to go, because in Brazil, the situation is very dire and complex, as you know, because you've been following. There is an impasse in Brazil, an impasse of a coup government. I'm not even talking about the investigations. Without investigations, they already have an impasse in their hands. With the investigation, gets even more intense. What's the impasse? Either they deliver what they promised to the media and to the market, which is the pension reforms and work, labor laws, reforms, and others, the land statutes, etc. And when they try to do that, they get weaker in the population's eyes, and it's already being contagion between the population and parliament. The parliament is already finding difficult to approve laws. Either they deliver and
will
get, they will not be useful anymore, their expression, they will come to the market immediately, or they deliver, and I believe that that will be, people will be dissatisfied in a monumental way, which will create an impasse in all areas. We do not know, we don't know. what will happen minute by minute, but we are clear about one thing. I criticize my deposition. My impeachment process, I criticize all that, but Brazil has a legislation, any removal today implies an indirect election if you're going to follow the Constitution. Direct elections in Brazil is chaos, total chaos. Why is it? I don't know if you've seen that yet, but you should be on the alert. Many people say the following. We have to discuss how, because if it was lack of dialogue that everything that happened took place, it was not. You can dialogue, yes, but you have to create democratic conditions for discussion. Democratic conditions for discussion or dialogue have to come through direct elections. The Brazilian legislation provides that from now on, if the president leaves his indirect elections up until October of 2018, when we will have our direct elections. Direct elections in Brazil, in any hypothesis, whatever happens in the interim, we need to understand that now at that moment there will be a presidential election, an election that will be the elections to give that gives support to any transition, whatever it is, and at the same time, we have to have an exclusive constitutional commission to create a legislative reform, because these people who are there under this system, this electoral system, I mean, the political electoral system that exists in Brazil, it's not, it's unfeasible to have any possibility of stability, economically or politically speaking. So I tell you this, from any angle that you look at, from any perspective that you look at the problem, there will be no condition of stability in Brazil without a democratic process of choice, without the Constitution being and the rule of law being in effect again. We're living weird times where we'll have to have a lot of firmness and determination, absolutely expand the democratic space. That's what begets us to do. I thank you for your struggle. I thank you for the demonstration of power that you gave us. It's not power in the sense of a brute strength, but it's the strength that comes from the inside, from your conviction, and transforms itself in hope in a certain way. This hope that you created to Brazilians here and in Brazil, you are also being looked at. Today you have this capability. So I thank you very much for the hope and for this show of democracy that you gave all of us. Thank you so much from the bottom of my heart.
Okay, we're going to have, we're going to only be able to take a few questions. The president has had an incredibly very hard schedule, and we don't want to exhaust her because she's gone to 5 universities. She's got 3 or 4 more to go to before she leaves the United States. So I'm going to just call in 3 people that raise their hand that I can see. The person here, and the woman back there, and a third person. Well, you're number 1, and you're number 2. Do I have a third question? And the person there, okay? Yeah. So if you want to come up and speak on the mic, you have the microphone there, please. Yeah.
Oi, boa noite a todos.
Good evening, good evening to everybody. The impeachment was illegal, it was illegitimate.
Anulada a democracia através da anulação do impeachment para eliminar golpes de Estado. The democratic process and elections.
My name is Lúcia,
I'm a teacher in Belo Horizonte. My question regards the judiciary power.
And very quickly, eu gostaria de saber se ao final a senhora pode fazer uma foto comigo,
minha
mãe é velhinha, ama a senhora.
Take a picture with you because my mom is old and she loves you.
Hi, Presidente Dilma, my name is Marcelo Maia.
My name is Marcelo Maia. I would like you to talk about the influence of media in Brazil regarding the coup.
And also, how are we going to have political reform if half of the Congress is being investigated?
I'm going to begin from the end. Obviously, I don't think it is possible to have an assembly, a constituting assembly made by those who have been elected to be congressmen and congresswomen, because despite of, even if we have a great renovation, nobody can ask the interested to mount a political electoral system that could be the best for the country. So we need an exclusive constituting caucus, and then it will be dissolved. This constituting caucus would have the power to make a political reform that would really be such that would guarantee democratic practices and ethical. I do not believe in that old thesis that nobody, that the fox would reform the chicken coop. We cannot expect people to be contrary to their own private interests. So the, in 2013, much was talked about reform, political reform for the inadequate practices of the parliament, of the politicians, or everyone in power. As I brought this forth as a president, and I was not able to have even move through Grand Congress, because the law does not allow me to make the proposal. I cannot propose our law. A political initiative cannot be exclusive initiative of the presidency. So what do I think that needs to be done? In a moment of crisis that Brazil is living through, above all, the political crisis nowadays, because they are interesting, they underestimated the crisis that they created, and now they are being caught by the creature they created. And at this moment, when it is necessary that some people are talking about dialogue, like if dialogue were possible without people's grassroots participation, without a proposal for changing the electoral, elective political process, it is a mechanism that I see as something that needs to be more democratic so that this can happen, the reformation can happen. The second question is very important because I think that another problem that exists in Brazil that we have never able to understand quite well, and I will explain why afterwards. First, I'm going to tell what it is. It is the question that in Brazil there is an immense concentration
of oligopolic
media.
Controla.
The media is controlled by
rádio, jornal, revista,
television, newspapers, magazines, and they're
então,
trying to go up the internet. It's something that comes from above. It's vertical.
Famílias, mais ou
basically,
menos,
there is four families that control media in Brazil. The process of oligopoly in the case of a segment such as communication
grave,
is extremely grave. Because it brings to the possibility of certain segments defend a single comprehension of the facts that is not democratic.
A história que fizeram no Brasil?
What is the history of Brazil that they are
telling?
They are trying to confound economic regulation of media with interfering in the freedom of press. This confusion is very advantageous for those who belong to the oligopoly.
Uma
because it tries to create an anti-competitive oligopolist as
a
suit
democrático.
That is
não é terno democrático. Não são
democratic.
Porque
but they are not democratic. They're just wearing a suit
uma visão
because
única.
They are defending a
são,
single
aliás,
opinion.
Não só, muito
they
pouco
are
democrático.
Not only not democratic, they
elitistas,
are elitists,
que têm uma visão
and they have a vision
that is
extremely precarious of the needs
não
of our country.
A menor
they have
responsabilidade
no
para
responsibility
então,
towards the people whatsoever.
É necessário.
So it is necessary
é necessário que haja regulação.
That there is
regulação.
A regulation of the media.
Eu sou a favor.
I am favorable.
Nesta área, haja também uma reforma. Agora,
there must be a reform also of the media.
Quando o inicinho do meu governo,
in the very beginning of the second,
of
my second mandate, when the coup process started, it happened with the arrival of Mr. Eduardo Cunha to the presidency of the federal Congress, the chamber, and to be to get to that post, there is an elect. There must be an election, and in the beginning of February, I was elected in November of 2013, and this happened in February 2014. During my campaign, I had spoken openly about controlling the economic oligopoly of the media in Brazil. And what happened?
O senhor candidato naquele momento,
the candidate
da Câmara negociou
of the president to the presidents of the chamber in order to stop criticism against him in the press, he negotiated with them a project of law, a provisional measure. A project of law in which the question of the regulation of media he would never let it pass because it has a power of over the agenda. So this is a question that needs also to emerge from the conditions that will be those that will come up from a discussion that is democratic through the ballots. This has to be something that needs to be, personally, I believe, submitted to a plebiscite.
Another thing regarding the illegality of the impeachment. There is no doubt that the impeachment has contaminated entirely the environment of the Brazilian institutional atmosphere. The relationship between the Constitution, that the Constitution demands that it be harmonic and that there must be a harmony among the powers. And the harmony has been disrupted, and all this has happened in ways that sometimes were very radicalized, such as the fact of the debate that happened between a minister of the Supreme Tribunal, the Supreme Tribunal, and the Congress, and there's a deterioration of our institutions in Brazil, because if the impeachment without a crime of responsibility, it's possible to depose the president, everything is possible. This is a very serious question.
Now,
I don't believe
que você consiga that you can institucionalmente hoje no Brasil refazer o processo de impeachment.
Porque
agora só resta uma instância.
Because now there is another instance, which is the judiciary, the
não
Supreme
acredito que
judiciary.
Julguem o processo
I
de
do
impeachment.
Not believe that they can
até
judge 2018. The impeachment process
não sou
before 2018.
Não,
I'm not that naive to believe that they are going to revert the institution just because they have beautiful eyes. They are not going to do that.
Porque, não vão, mas é óbvio que não. Agora, o que eu estou dizendo é o seguinte, nós temos
what
uma
I'm
conjuntura no Brasil extremamente
is
complexa.
That is extremely complex today
pode
in
ter várias alternativas.
There may be other
mas
several
eu quero
alternatives,
falar assim, sinceramente,
but
não acredito que essa seja uma das alternativas.
One of the alternatives that are going to be possible.
Pode ocorrer,
it
mas eu
happen.
Não vejo movimento social nem
movimento
de pressão para isso.
Or a pressure toward that.
Aí é outros 550, né?
No, that's another question.
Mas eu acho que tem uma vontade política que
but
nós
I believe
temos
that there is a political will that we must have. We must have the political will to amplify democratic space.
É muito difícil para alguém.
It is very difficult for somebody.
É muito difícil para mim.
It is very difficult for me.
Dizer
to say
de forma pessimista
in a pessimistic
a
way about my own situation.
Mas
but
eu acredito hoje
I believe today
que tá na pauta,
that
pelo
what
menos
is
é manter a eleição de 2018.
On the table is to
porque
maintain
é
the election in
tá
2018 because it is that election that is
acho,
at risk from my point
acho
of view.
Que eles
I think that they
armados,
are armed
até os dentes, não
to the teeth
literal da palavra.
Not literally.
É porque lá no Brasil não tem a mãe de todas as bombas.
Because Brazil doesn't have
ah,
the biggest bomb of all.
Em todos os dentes, com todos os dentes, para
but
quê?
They are armed
para
to the teeth.
Não perder o golpe que deram.
To not lose the coup that
em
they have
momento no futuro.
Done
é esse o problema.
In any
não
other point in the future. They do not want to
e
lose the coup that they
won. Pela dificuldade do governo golpista.
And that is the difficulty of the coup mongers is to impose their agenda while the national elections are approaching. I don't think that there is a question of postponing the election. They are trying to destroy the Constitution.
A situação no Brasil
I think that the situation in Brazil is
muito, muito delicada.
Very delicate.
Eles podem tentar vários mecanismos,
they can try several mechanisms, including the condemnation of President Lula. They are not crazy to
mas
arrest him.
Vão tentar
but they are going to try to condemn President Lula. I do not believe that they are going to be
e
so crazy as to arrest him.
Ser também and saída eterna,
it can be the eternal
eterna
way out for them. It is parliamentarism. They always try that. Or any other measure that is casual.
É uma situação extremamente delicada.
I think it's a very delicate situation.
Que essa situação
in this
a contradição tende a se aprofundar, nós não sabemos se,
ever-deepening,
e aí eu te respondo, se não terá
aggravation.
And
if there is no, we don't know if the political situation is not going to be even more aggravated now. And we know that the media now does an alternate game. And I have the impression that they are going to try to play the game of sit down, the lion is tame.
I want to thank all the organizers for this event, and especially the person who has been fundamental for this trip of the President, Diogo Santana, who helped organize this tour. And we should remember something we learned from the Portuguese colonies, a luta continua.
Hello. We just have final announcements that we have our, please visit our page, Defend Democracy in Brazil, in Facebook. We will have fundraising parties coming. We will have a lot of activities. We will be on May 1st marching with all the workers and all international movement in May 1st here, like we did that last year. We also will be on May 3rd. We'll be here alert, monitoring the judgment or the condemnation or whatever of President Lula. We won't permit that they will do this with our President Lula. Thank you very much. In the name of DDB, Defend Democracy in Brazil, here is our crowdfunding to fund and support Defend Democracy in Brazil, and to pay for our expenses here today. So we hope we will enjoy also our page that always has fresh news and monitoring all the situation in Brazil. But yeah, we also have Instagram, and we also have our Twitter, very active for who of you that want to follow the situation in Brazil. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Gente, só uma coisa, eu sei que muitos de vocês querem uma foto com a presidenta, um abraço, só que o palquinho aqui é muito pequeno e vai cair se todo mundo vier aqui. Eu vou pegar a presidenta e a gente vai girar, vamos na frente da exposição lá, que é bem mais aberto. Isso, e dá pra... Se não, aqui vai cair.
Let's set up here a nice picture. Não, gente, vamos contar. Depois vai. Na fila, não sei. Vamos fazer uma foto aqui. So.
Então ela vai sair para lá, eu vou poder tirar meu selfie lá.
Muito bem. Please, gente, todos os militantes aqui do DDB que querem fazer aqui uma foto. É, uai, aí não deu. Você?
Obrigado.
Joia.